in the real world, there's one common principle that underlies all the three categories. How easy do you think it is for an Indian, a poor Indian, an illiterate Indian, to actually reach Iraq or to reach Spain or to reach any country where he's found either as an irregular migrant or as a refugee or as a smuggled or trafficked person? So I think the first thing you must recognize is that all of these are objects of cartels. An irregular migrant doesn't go on his own. Yes, they do. There may be an odd case. But first of all, I think you should know that India has the least number of irregular migrants in the world. Okay? And India's unstated policy has been zero tolerance to irregular migration, emigration. Okay? But then what is happening is that there is need to act against the cartels which actually control irregular migration, even in Punjab, and cartels which control smuggling. So irregular migration is simply enabling a cartel or a group of people who are nothing but, it's a crime cartel, which enables people either on without documents, meaning they have a passport, genuine passport, no visa, helps them enter another country, or produces fake documents and enables them to enter another country, right? But the result is that there are groups that are enabling them to happen. Smuggled are those where I will ensure as a smuggler that you are helped to cross the border, after which you are on your own. I mean, I don't care what happens to you. A trafficked person is one where I continue to control what you do after you have entered that country, including the work that you do and so on and so forth. Now, the real challenge, I think, that we should pose is to these cartels. So the reason why there should be emphasis on combating irregular migration, combating smuggling, and combating trafficking is because there is a moral hazard involved. If we don't attack these cartels, people will continue to become objects and victims of the smuggling and trafficking. On the question of did government act in time, well, I'll put it this way. I am on the civil society side now, okay? I'm looking at it from a different prism altogether. But just to be correct on facts, for emigration purposes, Iraq is a banned country, okay? From India's policy, stated policy is that Indians should not work in Iraq, simply because it was a conflict zone, it was not even being regulated by international organizations, American military was not handling law and order there, surrogates for, were handling, Blackstone was actually managing all the law and order there. So government had taken a decision, Indians should not go to Iraq. Now, what used to happen was these cartels would actually enable them to go first to, say, Dubai, and then from there on to Iraq. So politically, it was very difficult for India. And, it's not so easy. If you're dealing with, in the real world, it doesn't work in the manner that a human rights lawyer stands up and thumps the table and say that, I want human rights. Yes, the ISIS fellow just shoots you and say, here are your human rights. So in the real world, it doesn't work that way. So I will not comment on whether India responded well enough, timely enough, or as one. I think it's fair to say that as a state, Indian consulates do try to do their best to protect Indian citizens. Sometimes they fail, but I don't think systemically we can say that India is a soft state, which the Foreign Service of which doesn't try to protect its citizens.
Thank you. For Madhurima, I think your presentation was quite comprehensive. But I was just wondering if you have any kind of information on Indians who are also detained abroad because either their visa expires or they become irregular migrants or they happen to travel abroad, like Sir said, on the wrong documents or whatever. Because Indians also constitute FNPs abroad.
So yes, the answer is we do. We did a study last year to understand what are the barriers in getting the Indians back home because, so there is an act called the Repatriation of Prisoners Act, 2003. Now that, it says repatriation, but actually should be transfer. That deals with transfer of prisoners from one country to another. So now internationally, a lot of countries have such acts or treaties between them, which allow their prisoners, like suppose an Indian is abroad, if we have a treaty with them, the Indian can serve the rest of the sentence back in India. So that solves a lot of problems in terms of the things I talked about the problems with deportation and nationality verification, because then, of course, you're back here. The moment you end your sentence, you are free to go. So there is no bureaucracy involved there. However, not a lot of Indians are actually taking it up, and that same goes for people here from other countries. They are not really taking the benefit of the Repatriation of Prisoners Act, which could be, there are, of course, issues of awareness. People don't know about it. There are issues of access. So even for Indians who are imprisoned abroad, there are two or three problems that the government faces, that's our missions face. One is they also don't get information of their arrest. So the police there also do not inform. In certain countries where there are very strict privacy laws, they are actually banned from informing. They can't share that information. Third is, so consular access is also dependent on the consent of the person. So if a person says, I don't want my embassy to be informed, there is no mandate or binding on the police or the prison department to inform. So one of the reasons that the MEA has been saying is that Indians don't want consular access. Now, I have a problem with that because it could also be the fact that Indians don't know what a consular person would do for me. So it's not really informed consent, or it's not an informed waiver in that sense. So those issues are there in terms of the embassy trying to contact the person. Now, other than that, the study we did looked at the barriers. You know, what are the problems in Indians trying to avail the Repatriation of Prisoners Act to come back to India? And there are quite a few barriers. And there is a handout outside. There's a flyer that we have brought today, which actually talks about the barriers in details, explains the process. And in terms of numbers, so the